The splendor of the window behind him drew Adela's attention as the lowering sun shone through and an open sky beckoned. The beautifully colored panes of glass were prison bars on this day. Her eyes closed as she summoned thoughts of happier days, playing with the cats in Edinburgh Castle, Gareth's attempt at writing, the meal the townsfolk had prepared for her. Kelvin said her name for some reason, and her attention came back to the present. She tried to listen to the words and repeat them, but they meant little to her.
I, Adela, take you, Miles, to be my husband, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for better or for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, from this day forward, until death do us part.
Clark put his hand out, and Stoddard stepped up smartly and placed a ring in Clark's hand. The wedding ring was an ornate masterpiece, rimmed with jewels. There were American mined crystal barrel, their gold and honey tones mingled with a sherry red topaz set on either side. Two oval citrines sat beyond that. It was a bold wedding band, not typical for Equatoria, diamonds being rarer in the Americas. Clark had also chosen not to include emeralds in the design, not because they'd clash, but more likely because Equatoria was famed for her gigantic emeralds. Senator Clark took Adela's hand with much ceremony for the benefit of the crowd and slipped the ring on her finger. It was heavy enough to feel like shackles. He grinned as he rushed through the vows and his mouth opened to utter his declaration of, "I thee wed," but a sudden crash of glass brought screams and shouts from the crowd. A shower of colored fragments from the beautiful window rained down just behind Lord Kelvin. The tinkling of 1,000 painted shards filled the air, even over the exclamations of the disrupted wedding party. Everyone came to their feet, moving backward or forward, depending on whether or not they were armed. Adela ducked her head, but then was up quickly, facing the window and whatever threat had dared to interrupt. To her annoyance, Clark attempted to push her out of the way, but she sidestepped his gallantry and moved toward her white guard, who were already running up the aisle, with Mamoru just behind them. A flutter of a long gray cloak around a tall, slim figure rose from a crouch amid the shattered glass.
"The Grey Friar!"
someone shouted. The room erupted with gasps and shouts and applause. Adela stood transfixed with astonishment and cried Grey Friar's name with elation. Smoky, glass-covered eyes snapped toward her voice. Without hesitation, she bounded around the stunned figure of Lord Kelvin as best she could in her bulky wedding dress.
"What are you doing here?"
she shouted breathlessly as Grey Friar reached out to her. "Come with me. You're in danger." Senator Clark ran toward his bride, rage smeared across his features. All his planning and hard labor were being taken from him by an upstart's ridiculous showmanship and utter audacity. Grey Friar swung Adela behind him and drew his sword as he faced the infuriated American.
"I'll have your head on a pike for this,"
Clark ground out through his clenched teeth. Drawing his saber, he charged, his sword swinging. Grey Friar countered his mad thrust, deflecting the blade away from Adela and himself.
"Don't kill him,"
Adela shouted, though to the gathering crowd it wasn't clear whom she was talking about. Blades rang as the rivals fenced past the empty throne. Grey Friar either didn't see or wasn't concerned with the 6 white guard rushing toward him, Colonel Anholt in the lead. A twist of Grey Friar's wrist and a flourish of his powerful arm sent Clark's saber flying from his hand. He kicked the disarmed senator in the chest, shoving him back into the oncoming soldiers. Anholt was the only one who managed to sidestep the pileup. Clark shouted,
"Kill him! Kill him!"
Grey Friar angled back toward the smashed window, guiding Adela with him. The crowd was surging forward now, half in outrage and half with wild excitement, consumed by the spectacle before them. A long rope hung from the broken panes. Grey Friar tossed his rapier to Adela, who caught it expertly. He seized her, then the rope, and began to scale the wall. He was aided by his vampiric flight, though done so subtly no one could tell. He carried her quickly up 30 feet to the sill of the smashed window. The train on Adela's gown hung to the floor below. She turned back to gaze over the chaotic Suez Hall, searching for her father. Her brother, Simon, was clearly visible, standing on a chair, waving his turban and cheering. Then she saw Anhalt hefting an ornamental dagger. She held out a desperate hand as if that would be enough to stop his fatal throw. The dagger flew through the air toward Greyfriar's head, but miraculously it missed, thunking with reverberating force into the window frame inches from his cheek. Greyfriar turned back to address the new threat, but Adela clutched him around the neck.
"He missed on purpose," she whispered hurriedly.
"I doubt that."
"Trust me, he doesn't miss."
With a perfectly controlled slash of his blade, Greyfriar cut the gown's long train, and it fluttered over the throne in a heap of satin and silk, while Adela kicked off her high-heeled shoes. The couple moved into a narrow ledge outside. From this dizzying perspective, Adela saw a huge crowd gathering around the palace. Shouts of Greyfriar's name echoed up from the square below. She also saw soldiers attempting to get through the thronged mass. Adela's veil caught hard, and her head jerked back painfully.
"Wait!"
She tore the tiara from her head and tossed it, veil and all, to the crowd below, who converged on the grand souvenir. The ensuing tumult slowed the guard's advance. Adela tried to manage her unwieldy dress as best she could for the moment, but it kept snagging on stone and iron fixtures as Greyfriar helped her to a more spacious ledge. "We have to hurry," he told her, searching around them.
"Wait!"
Adela grabbed his arm.
"What are you doing? What am I doing?"
"You are in danger," she laughed.
"Danger? How? From a boring life, maybe, but..."
"Cesare planned to kill you during the wedding." Adela rubbed her forehead in disbelief.
"That's why you've come? Wouldn't a warning have sufficed? You couldn't have sent another cat with a hidden message?"
"No time. I had to come myself."
"I do have an entire army to protect me."
"You had an army in France, too, and you ended up in Cesare's power." Greyfriar took her by the shoulder with a grip of sincere intensity, as if convincing a disbelieving child of some difficult fact. "I came because I had to. A message would not serve."
"I can't just run away."
"I trust your life with no one but me." Greyfriar's voice was burdened with desperation. "Please, Adela, this place is dangerous for you."
"But..."
"Do you want to marry Senator Clark?"
"No,"
Adela said quietly, as a flutter of excitement born of a free horizon rose up inside of her. Then her face grew more determined.
"No, I don't." "All right, then. Let's go."
She looked around the windswept ledge.
"I hope you have transportation waiting for us."
"Transportation?"
"Don't you have an escape plan?"
Adela cursed before laughing desperately.
"We need to work on your forward planning."
"My plan was to get to you before you were killed. I came all the way from England. I barely reached Alexandria in time." With Greyfriar's balance and strength, they gained the rooftop of Victoria Palace and, to their great relief, found it empty. They could see the Mediterranean crowded with ships just below them, as well as the Nile Delta and Lake Mareotis sparkling in the descending sun.
"We need to get out of this city."
Adela grabbed Greyfriar's hand, pointing south.
"That way."
"North is faster."
"Like when you dragged me to Edinburgh to escape from London? Just trust me."
An iron door crashed open and troopers poured out onto the roof. They quickly spotted the couple. Greyfriar and Adela ran to the parapet. With his arm around her waist, he pulled her close and jumped. Adela's breath left her as they flew through the air in a barely controlled drop to another rooftop almost 30 yards away. The guards rushed to the edge, but no one dared make the jump. They lifted their rifles, but no shots followed. Adela and the Greyfriar ran for the next roof in the palace complex. He again grabbed Adela's waist and jumped down to a lower level. Changing direction multiple times, they ran from peak to peak until they reached the high outer palace walls. They paused and looked down to a dark corner of the city below. He pulled her tight against him once more. She exhaled against his neck and wrapped around him as he jumped, never tiring of the free-fall sensation when in his arms. In seconds, they were outside of the Victoria Palace grounds, but few citizens were allowed in this part of the city so close to the palace, which is why Adela had led them here. She tugged Greyfriar into an alley, staying hidden as much as possible from eyes that might still be on high palace spires, watching for them and signaling to the soldiers on foot.
"Give me your cloak."
He tugged off his cape and wrapped it around her shoulders. She drew the cloak tight around her.
"At least I won't be as obvious."
The Imperial Quarter fell away as they ran into the Turkish Quarter, which Adela knew well. People were at their windows, caught up in their own daily routines. A few glanced down at the odd couple. Some pointed. Adela was sure they were a sight. Her and the remnants of a white wedding dress, wrapped in a long gray cloak, running alongside a soldier wrapped up like a Tuareg with smoked glasses, armed to the teeth. Adela led the way as they curved around the western harbor. She kept to back streets near the water, where laborers continued to ply their trades no matter the holiday. It would be impossible to remain undetected for long. They had to leave Alexandria quickly. Orders were no doubt already flying to lock down the city. Roads would be closed. Rail and air would be suspended. Shrill whistles sounded, and Greyfriar tucked Adela into a dark alcove where they pressed close against each other as a squad of police raced past. Greyfriar's attention stayed on the street for another minute until he was content immediate danger had passed. Turning back to Adela, he watched her as she ripped out another layer of satin petticoat from under the massive skirt and tossed it aside. She glanced up and caught his bemused smile.
"Oh, believe me, I have more."
He fingered a delicate curl of her hair. "You look exquisite." He lifted his smoked glasses, and their gazes finally met in a moment of calm, his pale blue eyes boring into her dark ones. Adela's hand pulled down the thick cloth wrapped around his mouth and chin until it revealed his lips. In the dark alcove, filled with frail drifting cobwebs and dust-covered timber, they kissed, passionately, desperately making up for months of separation.